everybody. Praise God. Praise his holy name. You know, I just get excited about my Jesus, man. I don't say excuse me. I don't make no bones about this. You know what I'm all about. I love the King of Kings. I love Jesus because I know what he's done in my heart. Not ashamed. You hear me, church? I'm not ashamed to worship the King of Kings. And I know you guys got to be. I know you love Jesus, and I know that you love to worship the King of Kings. We're going to deal with something today that has been on my heart for, I don't know, 2 or 3 years. And we're just trying to open this up, unpack this. We're going to unpack this little by little. We're like you know, it's a package, and you start going this, and you start doing this, and you start doing this. Right now, today, we're just going to do this. You hear me? Because, Pat, you know, there's a lot to unpack, especially when you start diving into the Word of God, when you start learning and God starts sharing some things with you by this Holy Spirit. You wanna do this and this and this and this, but the Lord said, no, I'm only going to give you this. Okay? And I want you guys to understand that this is important. You have to understand this. God has been dealing with me as pastor, as the leader of this church, because we're growing, there's a lot of new people here. There's a lot of new people that are from the street that don't understand. And I love that because I get to teach you. I get to teach you what's up. I get to teach you what this word means, and I like that. And so don't think that, you know, first of all, pastor don't know it all. I'm learning with you. Okay? I'm learning with you, man. So I said, Lord, you gotta teach me. You gotta teach me. I don't understand all about this worship stuff. You have to teach me so I can teach your people. And when your people starts getting this, when I start getting this, when we start getting this, there's something gonna happen. There's something gonna happen. So we're going to deal with that today. But before we get into the word, is there something that, you know, I'm in no hurry, okay? You guys all know that. But this church, we like to express what God has done in our lives. See, the church is so worried about this. I have this just for looks. I don't even look at this, you know. Matter of fact, that watch up there, that clock up there is that the right time? No, it's the right time. Okay. So I just want, I don't worry about that. Okay. I said, because when you love to be around this is church. Okay. This is church. And when you like to be around something, when you're doing something that you love, I know you all want to watch football. You love watching football. You all love baseball and all this stuff. And you can sit, some of y'all can sit in a computer for 3, 4, 5, 6 hours because you love doing that. But I want you to understand, when you come to church, we're the church today, right now. I want you to fall in love with the church. And when you fall in love with the church, you fall in love with the presence of God. It's like you're hungry for the presence of God. You have to come in prepared mentally, in your mind, ready for the presence of God, the glory of God, to fall into place. And things can change. Things can change. And things can change. I don't know what's going on in your life, but things can change like that when the glory of God is amongst his people. There's so much for me to teach, and I'm excited because I'm learning. It's important, even now as a church, to understand what's going on with the worship.
Well, like I said, this is a topic that as I'm studying and I'm reading, this is a topic that going to be a part 1, 2. I don't know. Who knows how many parts it's going to have to, because just keep my wife in prayer today. You know, it's funny how when you miss your wife, you know, she comes in, she takes care of all the stuff that I really, you know, I'm downstairs trying to get stuff ready. I'm going back and forth, and I'm trying to, you know, you know, it's just like, you know, when your wife is not with you by your side in ministry, it's tough. It's next to, well, that's the way it's supposed to be. You're supposed to be together. And today showed me that my wife is, I've always said this, she's the backbone of this ministry. I'm with her. You know, she's with me, and we can't divide. We work together. And I need her as well as she needs me. And I'm always lifting her. I'm her greatest cheerleader, I'm telling you. So I want you to keep my wife in prayer today. She was feeling under the weather. She called me this morning, and she, you know, she had all her stuff ready and everything, you know. And this morning she calls us. I'm here at the church, you know, getting ready. She couldn't make it. So, and thanks for my leaders. They got on track, and we're right on, you know, like that's what good leadership's all about. And that's why I train, and I they know what I expect, and I just pull the rubber band and stretch and stretch and stretch and stretch. That's what this is all about. This is ministry. Every one of you have worth. Every one of you have something to do for God. This is not just pastor church. This is your church. This is your church. And what I do is train people for ministry. We got a man, Aaron. He's going to go to his first mission trip here in June or July. By the way, April the 11th, we'll be having the Breath of Life people. They're going to minister. You get to talk to them. You get to see what's going on in the world. He did say that he's opening something up in Pakistan, and Venezuela. There's a couple other ones that they're opening up. So we will have missionaries coming from here. Guarantee it. We're going to have missionaries coming from Harvest Time. We're going to have pastors. We're going to have teachers. We're going to have preachers. We're going to have ministers. We're going to have teachers that teach Sunday school and all these things. Because, you know, it's not just me. It's you. It's all you guys, all you men and women of God that has this is a part of, you're the church. And so I'm very proud of my leaders and for putting up with me sometimes. But I, you know, they know I love them. They know I take, you know, I do whatever. I'll give you my shirt and I put it on you and button it up. I have to. Whatever it takes to get to that level and what God wants us to be and go. And we're getting there. I see God moving. I see God doing things. Okay? So let's talk about this last song we sang was about worship. Right? It's just, you know, last week we talked about Paul and Silas. They prayed and sang praises unto God in prison, in shackles. Remember that? And you wonder, how can that happen? How can these men pray and continue to pray and praise God and worship God and sing praises in shackles and in prison, all beat up? How can that happen? How can that happen? You know? So it's about worship. Yeah, we're gonna deal with worship. A lot of y'all come here and you think, you know, you're doing all right because you sit on the bench. But how much is we're going to deal with worship? We're going to deal with what we're going to get deep in this because we have to understand. I really don't think the regular, if you ask a Christian, what is worship? What do you do? All we worship? What's that? If somebody from the street would say, what are you doing going to worship? I know what we do at a bar. I know what we do at a house and get high. I know all about that. But what are you talking about worship? What does that mean? If somebody would ask you, what would you tell them? What would come out of your mouth? See, I always look at myself. If somebody come to me and ask me, how am I going to explain this to that individual? I'm here to teach you guys. So when you go out there in the street, you know how to respond to an individual. Don't give them something that's way out there and they're still seeing, scratching their head and say, what? So I want you to, I'm going to give you some stuff today. And it's, like I said, it's going to be just one unpacking. There's a lot of stuff we got to unpack. But I'm not going to unpack all that today because it's impossible. And I don't do that. I want you to learn something. If you get a nugget or two today and walk out that in your pocket and live it and understand what this worship means, then we did something today. Okay? So what is worship? Question mark. We're going to deal with today with the subject of worship. Worship. To worship is to quicken
the conscience by the holiness of God. Quicken the conscience of the holiness of God. To feed the mind with the truth of God. Listen to me. You're going to feed the mind with the truth of God. To purge the imagination by the beauty of God. To open the heart to the love of God. I'll give you guys something today. To devote, listen to me, to devote the will to the purpose of God. What is your purpose? I stretch you guys here, man. I challenge you. I don't want you just coming in here and sitting on the bench and say, go home. You might throw your stuff in here in the basket and see you later. Some pastor would be happy with that. And see you later. Bye. Not me. Not pastor. Because I got a vision God's given me. God has given me a huge vision. And it's still unpacking. It's still just coming up. There's so much that God is showing me. And God says that you can't handle what I have for you yet. Oh, yes, I can, Lord. Yes, I can. 9 years ago, I wanted all this stuff, and now I'm beginning to see God was right again. So many of you have callings of God. The English word worship is derived from the word worth and ship. It comes from worth and ship, meaning one worthy of reverence and honor. One worthy of reverence and honor. When we worship, we are declaring God's worth. God's worth. We worship because God's worth. He's worthy. You with me? I'm going slow. I want you to get this. I want you to understand this. Revelation chapter 5. I'm going to take some out of the book of Revelation chapter 5 verse 12. Well, let's go verse 11. Verse 11. And I beheld, John says, and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne and the beast of the elders, and the number of them which was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. Let's pray. Father God, we worship you. We glorify you, Lord. We need you, Holy Spirit. Without you, we can do nothing. We ask today, Father God, that you be lifted up. You are worthy of praise and honor and glory. Thank you for salvation, the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you for a new heart. Thank you for a new mind. I pray in the name of Jesus that you touch hearts, minds, souls, and spirit, and bodies, oh God, and change us. In the name of Jesus Christ, right now we ask, amen. Get ready, folks, because he's here. Without the Holy Spirit, we got nothing. You hear me? I don't care what you think you have. I don't care how much money you have. I don't care how nice looking you are or whatever. You have nothing without the power of the Holy Spirit. We're talking about worship. Don't fall asleep on me. Because I got something to teach you today. You have to understand what's going on. What is worship? I'm going to take it through the Word of God. Look what it says here. Them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands. Meaning in the Greek, it actually means myriads of myriads. meaning countless, extremely great numbers. So many that we can't even comprehend. God's got his angels in heaven. Our little finite mind cannot comprehend what God has up there. We're talking about worship. Verse 12, look at this. Saying with a loud voice, wait a minute, it's going to be loud up there? A loud voice. When you got millions and millions and millions of angels saying something, it's not going to be quiet. We're talking about something that's so grand that I cannot comprehend this. All the books that are made from all this worship books and everything else doesn't even come close to what's in heaven. What a God, mighty God we serve, right? But look at this. Saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. Praise God. That's a whole study in itself right there for 3 weeks. I don't have time to break it down for you. You do the study. Let me keep reading. 13, and every creature which is in heaven and on earth and under earth, and such are in the sea, and all that are in them, heard I saying. In other words, everyone, everything that God's created is saying this. Again, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb forever and forever. Praise God. Verse 14, and the four beasts, living creatures, said amen. And the four beasts and the four beasts and the 20 elders fell down and what? Worshipped him who lives forever and forever. He's always lived. He's never died. He's always been here. Wow. Try to figure that one out. I'm going somewhere with this. By the way, the Christian will never die. You might be in a box in your body, but we're never going, because when we die, we live. We see people in the box, right there at the funeral, but that's only the outer. I'm going to keep going. Praise God. Praise God. The biblical term for glory is often attributed to God as man proceeds to worship him. The word glory, listen to me, means honor or weight of God, or glory or the weight of God. So the word glory means honor or weight of God. You know, God is a heavy God. He's got a lot of weight. Our God is heavy, man. He's got a lot of weight. Have you ever, you're praying, all of a sudden the power of the Holy Spirit just comes upon you, and it's heavy? It's just so heavy, you just fall on your face, and you just start weeping. It's coming. As corporately, we're going to get there. But God, is the honor and the weight of God. Let's talk about the weight or the glory of God. We're going to go a little bit deeper. The weight or the glory of God. Isaiah 6. I will start with one. Look at this.
Look at this. This was a vision Isaiah had, just like Paul had last week. Isaiah had a vision about this, okay? He wasn't sleeping, he was awake, and God showed him this. In the year that King Uzziah died, and I saw the Lord sitting upon the throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Verse 2, above it stood cherubim. Cherubims, each one had six wings. Look at this. Six wings, with twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. So here's a creature that had six wings. That person, that creature will cover his eyes, and the other two wings will cover his feet. And the other two wings, he'd fly. This is what's going on in heaven, guys, okay? Verse 3, look at this. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. We're talking about glory. Holy is the Father. Holy is the Son. Holy is the Holy Spirit. That's another teaching right there. Verse 4, look at this. And the posts of the doors moved at the voice of him who cried, and the house was full of smoke. Verse 5, and said, look at this, look what Isaiah said. Then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of the people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King of the Lord of hosts. In other words, he says, in other words, you got Isaiah, which loved God, close to God. And as he gets closer to God, he sees himself of a man of unclean lips. And then he sees the world as all jacked up too. Why is it when you get closer to God, there's more conviction? I don't like the way I feel. I get convicted. So here's a man that loves God. He was a prophet for God. He was very close to God. But as he got closer to this light, he looked at himself as what he really is, all jacked up too. And then he gives revelation of the world. He's walking around and looking at this world is all jacked up. And he starts praying for these people. See, the closer you get to God, the more God is going to reveal your messed up junk life. See, this is not popular. But this must happen. This is normal. The church says it's not normal, but Isaiah is saying this is normal. This must happen. You want to be a man and woman of God? You want to be for his glory, for his purpose? This is going to happen. A man among clean lips, and all the people I see that dwell amidst of the people I see are also jacked up too, unclean. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.
What Isaiah saw, he produced, what produced in him was a deep feeling of unworthiness. Humbleness. Not walking around like he's all that and he's look at me. Brokenness and sees himself as he really is. Look at verse 6. And flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal on in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs of the off the altar. Verse 7. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, this has touched your lips, and your iniquities is taken away from your sin, and your sin, I mean your iniquity taken away, and your sin is purged. Who can only purge? Who can only take away the sins of an individual? Pastor? Your wife? Your husband? Your kids? Your money? Your fame? Your fortune? Jesus Christ! Jesus Christ! That we're talking about glory. We're talking about worship. So he's saying that he's the only one. Jesus Christ is the only one that can take your iniquities away, your sin. He's the only one that can be purged. You can be purged and by his atoning blood, by what Jesus did at Calvary's cross. See how everything points to him? Don't point to pastor, because pastor don't atone your sins or anybody else. I want you to love me. I want you to respect me as your leader. But I don't deserve worship. We say that, but we have our we people like to worship other people. We're looking at some things here as of worship. It's just like I said, we're starting to just unpack this a little bit. Let me go a little bit more. Verse 8. Also I heard a voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Then he said, here I am, send me. You can read the rest of that, but this is so. When I was reading this, I just a sense of unworthiness, and say, Lord, thank you for saving me. Thank you for doing that work in me. Thank you that what you're doing in my jacked up life. See, that's why I tell you guys, well, Pastor, why are you saying that? Why do you say you? Why do you talk down to yourself? No, I'm not. Because the closer you get to God, the closer you get to His holiness, the more He exposes who you are. It was so bad that God had to roll up His sleeves in heaven and said, "Okay, I'm going to take care of this myself. I'm going to come down, and I'm going to produce myself in flesh." Oh, wow. The result of revelation of Jesus. Luke 2:14. Let's take a look at the New Testament. Luke 2:14. We're talking about glory. What it says here. Glory to God. Glory to God. Not glory to man. It says, glory to our Father God. Glory to Him. In the highest. No, He is the highest. There's nothing more higher. You get that? He's the only one that deserves the glory. You don't got to be mean to somebody. Well, I'm not going to. No. You respect them. You respect men and women of God. You respect them. I heard somebody one time when I first started this, oh, you're just a man. Thank you. I mean, see the way people speak and the way, and this was supposed to be a Christian. Oh, you're just a man. What I said last week, you treat the man of God, the woman of God with respect. Was that respect? No. See, God's listening to everything you're saying. How do you say it to people? Or you're just a man. Thank you. I know I'm a man. But the way that individual was saying it was a sign of not respecting. That's why I'm trying to teach you right. When you go out there in the street, you go to another church, I'm teaching you right. They're going to know where you're from. Harvest. Oh, yeah. Okay. He teaches right. Because I've had so many people come in here, they're all jacked up. No respect. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace. Peace, peace, peace. That's one of the fruit of the Spirit, right? I taught on it for three months. Y'all should know what peace is. He's the only one that can give true peace. No one else can. No one can give true peace. Only our Father, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. Goodwill towards men. In other words, this is why Jesus came, man. This is why he wanted to give this peace to the world. There's a lot of scripture that goes with that, but I'm going to keep going. The Greek term most often indicating worship in the New Testament, meaning literally to kiss the hand towards one or to prostrate oneself before others, in token of reverence. Jesus used this word when he said to the woman in Sychar, John 4:24. Look at this. Let me go for 23. We're dealing with worship. But the hour comes, Jesus said, and now it is now when the true worshipers. He tells me there's not true worshipers. There's two types of worshipers. Worshipers that are not true, and then worshipers that are true. I know it's basic, but come on. Just because you're in church doesn't mean you're a true worshiper. I'm teaching you guys something. You're going to learn. So it says here, but the hour comes, it's now, when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeks. In other words, he's trying to find some. He's looking. For true worshipers. He's like this. Where's my true worshipers at? There must not be abundant of true worshipers. He's looking. He's finding. He's trying to find true worshipers. It's just because they got a cross on the front of their church, or they got a three-piece suit, or they drive a Cadillac, and they got money, a lot of money in the back, don't mean that they're true worshipers. Oh, come on. I haven't heard an amen yet. Y'all looking at me like, Pastor, here you go again. We're unpacking it. We just went to the first phase. You're going to learn something. He's looking for true worshipers. He's seeking true worshipers. He's looking for that. That's what he yearns for. That's what he's created us for. Worship. When Adam and Eve were walking with God, the Bible says. They were walking with God. They were worshiping with God. I don't even know what that means, man. They were worshiping with God. They were walking with God, Garden of Eden. And all of a sudden, something happened. Old Leadfoot says, hey, man, you can do it over. You can eat that apple. It's good for you. It's got a lot of vitamins. It'll get you smarter. You'll look good. A lot of things, good things can happen to you. And the flesh goes, really? Oh, my goodness, I want that. Good things, good things, good things. See, that's what the enemy tries to tell you. Go over there and check this out, man. It's good for you. It's in your pocket. Your phone. There's a lot of good stuff in there. I can see everything with this. Man, oh, man. I'm touching some toes right now. I sense it. And when they fell from the worship relationship. God had everything for them. This whole thing was theirs, man. This is all yours. Reproduce, man. It's all yours. I did it for you because I love you. I gave you my best. It's like he wants to give you your best. He wants to give you the best for you. And they fell. And he had to restore relationship with us. And the bulls and goats, the sacrifices, that the hundreds and millions of animals that they were sacrificing back in the Old Testament was pointing to Jesus. And what he was going to do at Calvary for us. But God says, well, it's not time yet. It's coming. But everything that you're doing right now is pointing to my son. And time, and time, and time, and time. And said, okay, now it's time. I'm coming down. I'm going to deal with this now. I want to restore relationship. By the way, in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit cannot live in you. He could live around you, and he was with you for a little time, but he could not live in you. But when Jesus died at Calvary's cross, he said, now I'm going to send the power of the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, to live in you. Relationship, restore relationship with him. This is what this is all about. Worship. Restore relationship with our Father. I'm just unpacking one thing right now. There's a lot to unpack. Thank you, Lord. Praise your holy name, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being here. You have your way today. I'm just a vessel. God is spirit. And those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Wow. What's that mean, Pastor? What's that mean? Father is looking for those who is worshiping that way, spirit and truth. Just like true prayer is only by the Holy Spirit. You hear me? True prayer is only by the Holy Spirit. True worship can only come from by the Holy Spirit. You hear me? That's why I say all the time, it's a privilege to have the Holy Spirit here. Without the power of the Holy Spirit in church, we got nothing but a gathering. And people are satisfied with that because they think because if we have a gathering here, we feed you, and whatever you come to church to get, you're happy with that. And you're happy because there's not a they don't understand the anointing and the power of this Holy Spirit. Because all worship is a response to a revelation. Now we're going somewhere. True worship is a response of revelation. Do you realize? Sometimes there's people here that are, got hands up in the air. They're crying. You see tears coming down. And you see all this stuff. You know, you see people doing. And they're really involved with their worship. But then you got a couple other ones, man, falling asleep, doing this, and they're like, you know, they're bored, you know, and all this stuff. And see, not that I'm picking on them, but they don't have revelation. When you come in and you have revelation of this Father God and Jesus and this Holy Spirit, it's on. It doesn't matter how you feel. See, that's what I'm trying to get the church to, because I'm telling you right now, God's told me something. I can't tell you yet, but that's why I gotta teach you. And they're not being taught. You don't understand the implication, the seriousness of this, the worship. You have to understand what's going on. There's a lot of stuff. You got a lot of commotion going on, but ain't nothing there. Commotion don't mean that's worship, by the way. Running up and down don't mean that's worship. It could mean, but not necessarily. Activity, noise doesn't mean that's worship. It could be, but not necessarily. So don't go look at places. Why? They got a lot of stuff going on. Yeah, they might have a lot of stuff going on, but is God the Holy Spirit there? I'm not satisfied with a lot of junk, a lot of stuff. It might be good, but we need worshipers that worship in spirit and in truth, that Father God said, what Jesus said. It's a deep subject. Huge. All worship is a response to a revelation. Don't ever forget that. All worship is a response to a revelation of God. John 4:23. But the hour comes now when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Truth only comes by the Spirit. Spiritual things are received by the Spirit. No other way. You cannot receive spiritual things by other than the Holy Spirit. You hear me? I want you to understand this. That's the only way. Trust me, I'm getting a lot of stuff out there. You're going to be taught right. You're going to be taught the ABCs of this. Because without having an ABC foundation, you're not going to be able to build anything. There's a lot of people trying to build churches. I mean, not trying to build churches, but trying to build spiritual houses. But they ain't got no foundation. They're not being taught. They might be speaking a lot of tongues, but they have no foundation. You can do that, right? So don't look. I'm not trying to build you something without a foundation in your walk and in your life.
Because without a foundation, man, you don't got nothing. Like Jesus said, there's going to be two houses, one on sand and one on the rock. The one on the rock was solid, man. The winds came and everything, the winds came and it didn't blow down. Maybe shingle here, maybe a broken window, but that was repaired. But the other one that was on sand, man, the winds came, the typhoon came and just tore that place up. Nothing left. And that's what the enemy wants you to do. That's what the enemy wants to do in your life. That's why the enemy tries to stop me every day. He don't want me to teach you. He don't want me to break it down in the ABCs because that's what I love to do. I want you to learn the Word of God. I'm in this for that's it. That God can help you. God can do what He has to do in your life and deliver you, set you free, and do that purpose that He's calling you to do in your life. That's why the enemy stops me. That's why the enemy wants to stop me. That's why the enemy tries to roadblock my wife and I. But I'm stubborn. I get harder. I don't back up. When you reverence, listen to me. When you're reverencing something, it's less requesting as you mature in Christ. Now, it's all right to ask for things. That's all right. I'm not saying that you don't ask for things. But as you get closer to this light, this heavenly light, you start reverencing Him. You're not asking for things no more. You're reverencing Him. Yeah, you might, you know, through my whole day, I might be asking Him for things, but and working hard at it. But this reverencing, this light, this glory, that's what it changes things. You just want to be in His presence. You just want to be close to Him. Lord, I just want to be close to You. That's all I want. Can I just sit next to You? More reverencing, less prayer request, more worship. You hear me? Less prayer request, more worship. In the second realm of reverencing, it moves from focusing on my needs. You're not focusing on my needs, on me. Nothing wrong with asking and praying for your needs. Nothing wrong with that. But as you get closer to this God and He becomes more and more real to you, you just want to be close to Him. Because when you're close to Him, things change, man. Things change in your mind, your heart, your soul, your body. Everything changes. And you're just not the same. Some of you are getting this, some of you aren't. If you hang here, you're going to get it. If you run, and you're in and out, in and out, in and out. Well, there's people that tell me, oh, Pastor, you preached a great message. I said, just come back. Well, they're not here today. If you really want something for God, from God here, you got to be hungry. You got to say, Lord, get me hungry, just like a Big Mac, your fries, your pizza, your ice cream. Your food that you like to eat, your favorite food. Lord, give me more hungry than the pizza. Give me more hungry than a Big Mac or the ice cream from Dietz's. They know me over there. How you doing, Pastor? The usual? No, I'm going to change it up today. Look, we dealt with the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5:22, for Paul, the true worship of God is a life of faith that shows forth fruits of the Spirit. I can tell you, man,
This is important. Put it up there. 5:22, Galatians. Paul said, this is the true worship. And I taught on this for 3 months, and in verse 23, Paul said, that's true worship. The fruits of that of your life. That's how you evaluate, you judge an individual. By this. That's what Paul said. I know, there's a lot here that I'm giving you. I'm just touching. Look at this, Romans 12:1. Romans 12:1. Look at this. Paul would say, I beg you, I beseech you, Christian. Starts right off, right off the bat. By the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Living sacrifice. Holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. That is deep. He wants that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. It's your lifestyle. It's how you live. You present your bodies, your body, your whole self as a living sacrifice to God. Man, that's deep. We're talking about worship. That's worship. Holy and acceptable unto God. That's the only way he's going to accept that, through the blood of Jesus Christ. Let me keep going. I'm going to get you out of here early. I hope. Worship is born, is both revelation and mystery. Worship is both revelation and mystery. Man experiences the presence of God in revelation and stands in awe of God in the face of mystery. How many times have you been in the presence of God sometimes? Maybe it was just you and him in a car, at home, maybe at church. He shows up to your stuff, and it's something overwhelming. It just happens, and you know it come from heaven. You know it come from the Holy Spirit. There no one can tell you no different. He shows up. It's a mystery. That's we have the privilege of worshiping the King of Kings. God both reveals and withholds himself at the same time. He reveals himself and holds back at the same time.
I can stay there, but I'm going to keep going.
Man can be conscious of God in his life, but he can never comprehend the ultimate meaning of God. We're talking about worship. I'm going to close with this verse here. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Chapter 3, let me see where we'll start at. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Okay, well, let's start with verse 20. I'm going to close with this. I gave you a break because of time change, okay? I'm just going to give you a break because I know, you know, it threw you guys off and people coming in late and everything else.
I'm going to be nice to you today. Come on. You hear me, Robert? Yeah. He looked at me and said, all right. He's got a face mask. He's probably saying, all right, Pastor. Don't get used to that because that don't always happen. Okay. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 20. Look at this. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise. He knows the thoughts of everyone. And to him, that they are vain. In other words, to God, it's empty nothings. It's nothing to God. Well, what? How smart you think you are? Times that by the whole world. Talking about worship. Think about that for a second. See, that's why. I respect everyone, but I don't get, some of you all probably say, oh, well, they're too smart, and they're so, they're jacked up just like you are. You can respect them, like them, but they ain't all up here. See, that's what we look at. The world looks at that. Well, they got a Cadillac, they got money, they got clothes, they got going on, but God says it's worthless to him. That changes things now. Keeps everybody in the equal plane. No one's better than anyone. Oh, my Lord. I'm going to keep going. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Praise God. Verse 21. Let no man glory in man. For all these things are yours. In other words, God's in charge. He's the one. We're talking about glory. He's talking about worship. He's the only one that deserves the worship and glory. No one else. When he shows up and takes care of your kid. Thank you, Lord. When he pays the bills, when there's no money there, but something comes in. Thank you, Lord. When you should have been dead, but you're alive. Thank you, Lord. When things look so terrible, and all of a sudden you get a phone call, and it changes everything in a second. Thank you, Lord. When you heard from the doctor that there's no cure, and there's nothing, you're hopeless, and something happens and touches your body, and you're healed, and there's a miracle. Thank you, Lord. You begin to think different. You begin to live different. You begin to respond different to your wife, to your children, to your boss, and you don't beat yourself up like you used to. You're getting healed mentally, physically, emotionally, financially. He's setting things up for you. Thank you, Lord. Worship. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You're here. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. I want you to just take in. Because the Holy Spirit wants to touch your mind. We're so used to hurry, 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 hurry. I'm learning that sometimes slowing down things and just thinking is a good way too. Taking in, reverencing. Verse 21. Therefore, let no man glory in man. Let no man glory in men, for all things are yours. Verse 22. Whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, which is Simon Peter,
or the world, or life, or death, or things present, or things to come, all are His. Everything's His. See, the world don't understand this. I'm trying to get you guys to think here. The world don't understand this, but you know what? Even the Christians don't get this. They're not being taught. And it's not being anointed by the Holy Spirit. It's not being pushed by the Holy Spirit. They're just reading those words. They're not being explained. There's no power behind it. There's nothing coming from heaven behind it. They're just reading words. And what's going on with the church, they don't understand what worship means. I've only touched barely the surface today. Everything I give you is a study. I want you to understand the subject of worship. Because I got to learn too first. I got to understand. God's got to show it to me. God's got to unpack this to me. He says, no, you're not ready for everything yet, but I'm going to show you a little bit. Lord, I'll take whatever you give me. This is a big God that we serve. It's a huge God. It's a humongous God. It is so big. He is so big that we can't even comprehend the God that we serve. We can't comprehend. And then you wonder why he can't help you or fix your situation. This takes faith, though. This takes faith. And say, Lord, I don't understand this, but you're gonna have to show it to me. You have to show it to me. I don't care what YouTube says. I don't care about this book that I'm reading says. I don't care. But you got to show it to me. Me first, Lord. I'm first in line. I'm greedy like that. All are yours. All is His. Everything. There's some people say, well, I work hard. Yeah, you work hard, but who's giving you the know-how? Who's giving you the health? Who's giving you the breath to get there? Who's giving you? Who's blessed you to do that? Worship! Well, I work hard. I work 7 days a week. 12 hours a day, but you know what? God can take away that breath in a millisecond. Worship!
Praise God. I'm going to close. I want you to understand when you come in this house, in the house of God, lay your stuff out there before you walk in, even actually before you even get in your car. See, I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy of being saved. I'm not worthy of what God has done for me. Everything He's done for me, I don't deserve. But some way, somehow, He seemed fit to bless me. The jacked up person that I am. And He begins to tell me, you know what, I love you. Begins to tell you, you know what, I love you. I want to change your life. So some of you all, God's got you on the hook. But you're like that. You're right. And He says, okay. And you just go out. But you still got that hook on you. You can keep on swimming. You can keep on playing out there and do it. But He still has that hook. And He says, okay. Let that fishing pole loose and let it go. But he's still. He'll bring you in, little by little. You can fight all you want. You can kick. You can throw. You can cuss, and you can say, "I'm not going." He'll let you go again. Ah, Lord, thank you, Holy Spirit. And then you out there swimming, and you think you're all happy. No one knows. And guess what? Oh, no, I can do what I want. Woo! I sense the Spirit. Ah, Lord. He starts pulling you in. He's been pulling you for a long time. What I tell you is stop fighting. You're on the hook already. You're already on hook. You're on hook. He's got you on hook, brother. He's got you on hook, sister. You can't break God's hook. He says he's in charge. What did he say? He's in charge of everything. You're on hook. You can try to hang it off. No. Hit God's hook. Don't come off. You're like, sis, I want the thing. I don't want it on me. Well, I know that. That hook didn't come off. Because he's got something for you. He's going to make something of you. He's going to make something of you. He's going to make something of you. He's already got a plan for you. He's already got a plan for you. He's already got a plan for you. My Lord. I don't know what you're doing right now. You can sit down. You can stand up. I don't care what you do. Just start worshiping and praising the King of Kings. Say, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me of my sin. Lord, forgive me first. I'm the first one that you need to forgive. Forgive me of all my sin, Father. Thank you for your Son, Jesus. That blood that was shed for me. We need to know you, Lord. We need revelation of you, Lord. We need the glory in this place. We have a big job to do, Lord. But we know without you we can do nothing. We know without you we can do nothing. We know without your glory, without your Holy Spirit, without the anointing, without you being the head of our home, we can do nothing. So we repent. I repent right now. I repent. I repent of all my sin. I repent of turning away from you. I repent of not listening to your Holy Spirit. I repent of being rebellion. I repent of turning away and not listening to your voice. Ignoring you. I repent of that. Lord, help us to be the man and women of God that you're calling us to be. That purpose, that mandate you have for your people. We have to learn, Lord. We have to learn. You have to teach us, Holy Spirit, how to worship you. To worship you, Father. To worship Jesus Christ's finished work. I pray in the name of Jesus that you touch my wife right now. In the name of Jesus. We're coming together corporately, and we bind that sickness in the name of Jesus. And when I go to see my wife today, she's going to be walking. She's going to be healed, and she's going to be set free. And God, you're a blesser. We come to you. Lord, we pray for people. We pray for families in the name of Jesus right now. You know what's going on. Now, people right now, put that situation, that name of that person right now, and give it to the Lord. Whatever, whoever you're dealing with, whoever you're fighting with, whoever is in your family member right now, the Lord's telling me to say that name and give it to him in worship. Watch what he does. Watch what he does. Watch what he does. He's in charge of it all. It's by faith. So, Father God, we just lay everything down at the foot of the altar. And we give it to you. Our children, our grandchildren, our great-great-grandchildren, our husband, our wives, our grandma, our grandpa, our children, all these people. We give them to you. We give them to you, oh God. Help us to show Jesus to them. This fruit of the Spirit. And there's somebody here that doesn't know Jesus Christ. Lord, we surrender them to you. Thank you for what you're doing at harvest time. Thank you for what you're doing in my life, oh God. Deliver your people. Set them free by Jesus Christ. Your will be done today, Father, in our lives. Help us not to get so much in a hurry and we forget you. Help us, oh God, continue to worship you every day, the good, the bad, the ugly. Continue to worship you. That, in fact, when we go through ugly stuff, the bad stuff, we start even worshiping you more through a storm. Thank you, Lord, for your people that are here, Lord. Touch them. Touch them, oh God. Deliver them in the name of Jesus. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you. It's a privilege that you settled in here, Holy Spirit. And we just thank you. We don't take it for granted. We worship you, Father. We worship you, Jesus, and we worship you, Holy Spirit. And we just want all you. We want everything that you have for us. Everything. We pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And amen. Thank you.